And so tonight, I'm going to address the broader lesson or lessons of the Dover case as they involve the concepts of judicial independence and accountability, and the ancillary but no less important topic of the need for us to elevate the debate as it relates to how courts perform their duties.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the second lecture in the Difficult Dialogue series at the Commons. The subject of this dialogue is knowledge, faith, and reason. We would also like to welcome Wichita State University, which is receiving a video stream of this evening's talk. I'm Leonard Krystalka, director of the Biodiversity Institute at the University of Kansas. It is an honor to present our speaker tonight, Judge John Jones III, who presided over the landmark case of Kitzmiller versus Dover Area School District in Pennsylvania and wrote the decision in December 2005. A few words about the commons. The grand challenge for society in the 21st century is understanding and stewarding the global commons, our shared physical, biological, and cultural resources of the planet for the common good. Achieving this understanding and this stewardship will require research and education that is integrative, innovative, bold, and boundary-breaking across the humanities, the sciences, and the arts. The Commons at the University of Kansas is a response to this challenge. It is dedicated to discovering knowledge of nature and culture and how they impact one another. And the Commons is, I'm pleased to say, a partnership between the Hall Center for the Humanities and the Biodiversity Institute. Following the lecture, the question cards that you received as you entered the auditorium will be collected along these center aisles. We will take as many questions as we can and as time allows. Please keep your questions short. It's also a pleasure to say that tonight's event is co-sponsored by Kansas Public Radio. Two reminders. First, tomorrow morning, 10 o'clock, in the Hall Center for the Humanities, Judge Jones will hold an additional dialogue that is open to everyone. And second, please check right now to see that your cell phones are turned off or muted. Thank you. My colleague, Victor Bailey, director of the Hall Center for the Humanities, will introduce tonight's speaker.
Good evening. A year ago, to the very day, the Honorable Judge John Jones III began presiding in a Harrisburg, Pennsylvania courtroom over Kitzmiller versus Dover Area School District, the first case to test whether it's constitutional for public school classes to present the argument of intelligent design. In December 2004, 11 parents had brought suit against the Dover Area School District. Tammy Kitzmiller was one of those parents, a high school graduate who worked as the office manager at a landscaping company. As of December 2004, she had a child in the 9th grade and one in the 11th grade at Dover High School. The Kitzmiller trial began on September the 26th, 2005, and continued for 6 weeks through November the 4th. Judge Jones rendered his verdict on December the 20th, 2005. It is a legal tour de force. In the modern legal battles over the teaching of evolution, judges have shown themselves to be averse to wading into the science of evolution and more averse to engaging the question of what constitutes science. Not so Judge Jones. The trial, as Margaret Talbot wrote in The New Yorker, quote, turned out to be rather like the biology class you wish you could have taken. Judge Jones allowed a mass of expert testimony, including that from the plaintiff's lead expert, Dr. Ken Miller, who was the first speaker in our difficult dialogue series. And Judge Jones refers to a good bit of this expert testimony in his judgment. He clearly believed that the courtroom is a proper venue for debating science. Indeed, his opinion states at one point, the court is confident that no other tribunal in the United States is in a better position than are we to traipse into this controversial area. His verdict should leave no one in any doubt. He concluded in this way, it is unconstitutional to teach intelligent design as an alternative to evolution in a public school science classroom. In making this determination, he declared that intelligent design is not science, and that ID cannot uncouple itself from its creationist and thus religious antecedents. As he stated, ID is grounded in theology, not science. But if we were expecting a verdict in cautious and convoluted legal language, all narrowly interpreted, we did not get it. Instead, we got a vigorous, hard-hitting, and comprehensive ruling. As a flavor of the judgment, this is from his conclusion. To be sure, he says, Darwin's theory of evolution is imperfect. However, the fact that a scientific theory cannot yet render an explanation on every point should not be used as a pretext to thrust an untestable alternative hypothesis grounded in religion into the science classroom. The citizens of the Dover area, he goes on, were poorly served by the members of the board who voted for the ID policy. It is ironic that several of these individuals who so staunchly and proudly touted their religious convictions in public would time and again lie to cover their tracks and disguise the real purpose behind the ID policy. And he went on further. Those who disagree with our holding will likely mark it as a product of an activist judge. If so, they will have erred, as this is manifestly not an activist court. Rather, this case came to us as the result of the activism of an ill-informed faction on a school board, aided by a national public interest law firm, eager to find a constitutional test case on ID, who in combination drove the board to adopt an imprudent and ultimately unconstitutional policy. He concludes finally, the breathtaking inanity of the board's decision is evident when considered against the factual backdrop which has now been fully revealed through this trial. The students, parents, and teachers of the Dover Area School District deserve better than to be dragged into this legal maelstrom with its resulting utter waste of monetary and personal resources. Judge Jones was appointed to his current position as a United States District Judge by President George W. Bush in February 2002, and unanimously confirmed by the U.S. Senate in July 2002. He hails from the anthracite coal region of northeastern Pennsylvania. He's a graduate of the Dickinson School of Law of the Pennsylvania State University. His career as a trial lawyer spanned nearly 22 years. He represented thousands of clients from all walks of life. In 1986, he formed his own law firm, where he practiced until his elevation to the federal bench. In 1995, Tom Ridge, then the state's governor, appointed him chairman of the State Liquor Control Board, where he served for over 7 years, placing strong emphasis on underage drinking at college campuses, as well as drunk driving. He also banned the sale of Bad Frog beer since its label displayed a frog making a rude finger gesture. He has received many awards over the years, including an honorary doctorate in law and public policy from Dickinson College. This evening, he will talk on judicial independence and Kitzmiller versus Dover Area School District. Please join me in welcoming to the KU campus the Honorable Judge John Jones III.
Victor, I thank you for that most kind introduction. There's little left for me to say. That's as long an introduction as I've had, and it's very, very kind and very cordial of you to highlight some things that I've done. Although I was afraid you were going to read the whole decision, and I was hoping that you weren't going to do that. It's 139 pages. We'd be here for a long time. It really is a pleasure for me to be here, and I was honored to be asked to speak as a part of the Difficult Dialogues series. I thank the Chancellor. I thank all of you for your hospitality, your very gracious hospitality. I have a wonderful room in the Eldridge Hotel, quite commodious and large. As I got into the room, I thought that I must be in the presidential suite of the Eldridge Hotel because the room is so large. And then I went into the bathroom, and it is an enormous marble bathroom, but it has his and her shower, so now I believe that I'm in the honeymoon suite, which is a problem because I'm here by myself, and that doesn't work out that well for me, but I've certainly been well treated. Now, as Victor noted, time really does fly, and it's hard for me to believe that just a year ago, or a year has passed, really, since I began to litigate, to preside over the litigation, that is, in the Kitzmiller versus Dover case. And I was, a year ago, at the epicenter of a legal and cultural clash that, by the time that I rendered my decision on December the 21st of last year, had attracted attention from almost every corner of the world. And for this federal judge, the experience was, and indeed continues to be, in a single word, surreal. Now, I'm aware that I was invited to speak to you, and indeed flown out here today from faraway Pennsylvania, because I am and probably will forever be known as the judge who decided the Dover intelligent design case. But when this gracious invitation came to me some months ago, prior to accepting it, I gave the caveat that if I spoke, it would not be to rehash the trial or my opinion on the issues presented to me for resolution. Now, there are good reasons for that. As a judge, you see, with literally hundreds of cases on my docket, my duty, what I'm charged to do, is to resolve a case and then move on to the next one. Sort of a workmanlike task, not as sexy as you might have anticipated. I am not unmindful of the fact, however, that the controversy concerning intelligent design continues, and that it has been at the forefront of a public debate right here in Kansas. But contrary to what some of you may believe, I come to you tonight not as some of your other speakers have and will, as an advocate for anything as it relates to the evolution intelligent design debate. That is not my function as a judge, and viewing your roster of speakers, I can easily see that having heard already from Ken Miller, and with the fact that you're going to hear from Richard Dawkins, for example, Eugenie Scott, and Michael Behe, among others, you're going to be, to the extent that you go to all these lectures, up to your eyeballs just the same way that I was last year with respect to these complex issues. Good luck as you hear these speakers out. Moreover, while folks like the ones that I just named have made these issues really part of the fabric of their lives and their life's work, I have not. And I hope that you understand that judges become only temporary experts with respect to the cases before them. Just like all of you, I can retain, particularly the older I get, I can retain for so long, only for so long, much of the information that I receive as it relates to a given case on my docket. Or put another way, the highly technical scientific testimony that I heard for 6 weeks last fall is rapidly becoming distant or even a non-existent memory for me. There are only so many parking places in your brain, and some of them get taken by other vehicles as time goes on. Now, all of this is not to say that I lack personal beliefs about these things. And that's going to get me to some of the things that I want to talk to you about tonight. I do have personal beliefs, but they are completely irrelevant. And for me to express them here on these issues is entirely inappropriate. So in the face of that cautionary, then why am I here? And what can I favor you with that will enhance the difficult dialogue series? Well, I think that there are a few things that I learned through the Dover case about judges and judging, and in particular, how our courts in America are perceived. And these things, I think, need to be addressed and talked about. And I made a determination that I would accept certain speaking engagements so that I'd have the opportunity because, as I joked at the beginning of this odyssey that I'm on, immediately after deciding the Dover case, federal judges don't get out much. But when we're invited, we should probably try to respond more frequently and talk about these things. Now, I noted that in preparing, when I was preparing for this address, that the website for the Hall Center states that part of the mission of the Hall Center is to sponsor special programs, quoting now, that engage the university and the wider community in dialogue on issues that bring the humanities to bear on the quality of life for all citizens, and that these events seek to understand our past, present, and future, our values and identities, and the essential issues we face as individuals and communities. And so tonight, I'm going to address the broader lesson or lessons of the Dover case as they involve the concepts of judicial independence and accountability and the ancillary but no less important topic of the need for us to elevate the debate as it relates to how courts perform their duties. Now, as I noted earlier, the Dover case is rapidly passing into history as it has been over 9 months now since I decided it and a year since I commenced the trial. But during the interval between when I received the case and today, I got it in December of 2004, I have been, as I just noted, on what I can only describe as a remarkable odyssey. In that time period, I have learned some very interesting and beneficial things, but I have also learned, to my chagrin, that people do not really understand how our courts work in the United States. It's critical for me to note that as judges, we tend to believe that the public understands that we do not approach cases with bias, nor are we susceptible to outside influences, either political or otherwise. But here's what I now know. That is not really what most of the public believes at all about the way that courts work. Consider this, if you will. When the Dover case came to me in December of 2004 by random assignment, there was much speculation as the case unfolded about my background and how that might predict the outcome of the case, my decision in the case. Written about quite expansively was that I was a lifelong Republican, that I was appointed to the bench by President George W. Bush, that I was a Lutheran who attended church. And in fact, let me quote from a post that appeared on a blog maintained by a prominent intelligent design supporter prior to my decision in the Dover case. And I'm quoting now from this blog. This was during the pendency of the trial, but before the decision. Judge Johnny Jones, on the other hand, is a good old boy, brought up through the conservative ranks. He was staff attorney for DARE, an assistant scoutmaster, political buddy of Governor Tom Ridge. Unless Judge Jones wants to cut his career off at the knees, he isn't going to rule against the wishes of his political allies. This won't be over until it gets to the Supreme Court. But now we own that too. And then came my decision. Now, contrast that blogger, that prediction, with the criticisms that followed my decision. These were criticisms not just of my decision, but of me personally. Bill O'Reilly, on his television program, deemed me a fascist judge. The Reverend Pat Robertson deemed me an arrogant judge who had rendered an absurd opinion, in the midst, I might add, of warning the entire Dover, Pennsylvania community that it was at serious risk of a natural disaster as a result of God's wrath for their improvident acts. This is true. And the conservative pundit Phyllis Schlafly complained that I had, by my decision, stuck a knife in those who brought me to the dance by ruling in favor of the plaintiffs in the case. Fortunately, possessing as I do a fairly cultivated sense of humor, these comments led me, immediately after I heard them all, to observe that I had been hit by a conservative critic trifecta of sorts. And I will note parenthetically that the mostly happy little community of Dover, as we are here tonight on September the 26th of 2006, still has not been wiped off the face of the earth and remains in place. But on a more serious note, these criticisms point up something in the way that both the pundits and the public tend to perceive judges. It is false, it is debilitating, and if unchallenged, I believe that it will ultimately tear at the fabric of our system of justice in the United States. What these critics and others have omitted in their analysis of my decision is, among other things, how the wisdom of our founding fathers led to the creation of our federal judiciary, of life-appointed federal judges, and the general establishment of our federal courts under Article III of the United States Constitution. They also neglect to observe or even endeavor to explain the role of precedent in judicial decisions and the fundamental concept of the rule of law. That is, the judges decide cases without fear or favor as according to the law, applying the law to the facts as they find them. Rather, to hear some critics tell it, and some members of the public, judges are free to find facts in a case according to their whim, to disregard precedent, and to decide cases based on a desire to please their political benefactors. While this is really an absurd misrepresentation of what we do, I will submit that it has been implanted into the minds of the public by the pundits, by the critics, and by people who just don't care to either understand or explain the way courts actually work. And if I accomplish nothing else during this period of relative notoriety for me as a result of the Dover case, I want to disabuse people of these notions. Simply put, many people apprehend that a judge should rule based on the popular will at any given moment. Put another way, and in the context again of the Dover case, if polls showed that many Americans believe that creationism should be taught in place of evolution in our schools, and I'll note that from time to time polls do show that, then many members of the public believe that courts should simply follow that lead and rule as according to the popular will. This, of course, is the product of a rank misunderstanding about what courts do. To those who believe that judges are able to cast aside precedent and rule in this way as according to an agenda that is private or that is based on political benefactors or is based on the public will, let me say that I believe that the public's dependence upon the impartiality and integrity of judges is absolutely essential to its confidence in our justice system. It is especially important that our citizens understand that judges must be impartial and that the independence of the judiciary is premised on a judge's pledge of freedom from not only partisan influences, but expressions of the public will at any given moment. Again, with reference to the Dover decision and putting it in that context, my decision in that case was guided by over a half century of strong legal precedent that had emanated from the Supreme Court of the United States, speaking to the separation of church and state. There were carefully crafted tests for me to overlay against the facts as I found them to determine whether the school board's policy violated the Establishment Clause. You may fundamentally disagree with those tests. I may disagree with those tests, but I did not have the opportunity to reject them. I was bound by the precedent as I found it in handling the case. My task in deciding the Dover case was really rather workmanlike. Notably, and again, this is omitted in many of the public criticisms, I did not have the power, again, to restate, nor did I endeavor to disregard proven facts on the record or, again, to disregard well-established precedent, nor could I make up a new test, a judicial test, to apply to the board's conduct. I did what I believe that all judges do in every case, what good judges do in every case, that is, I approached the Dover case without a political agenda, a bias, a predisposition, or of a thought that I decided it in a certain way that it would offend political benefactors. I merely applied the law to the facts as I found them, simple as that equation might seem. As Victor noted, I predicted something in my opinion that came to pass in that subsequent to the release of the Dover opinion, some labeled me an activist judge. I hope that you can see by my explanation here tonight that I was not that at all. And indeed, that phrase is really misused today because it's used to apply to any judge with whom a person or a group of individuals disagree. Had I determined the facts in a way that was not based on the testimony, or if I had disregarded established law, or, as I said, made up my own test, then the Dover case, the Dover decision, that is, would have been the true work of an activist judge. It was not permissible for me to do that. It is never appropriate, and it is not appropriate, certainly, for me to project my personal beliefs or biases in deciding a case. That would be ad hoc justice, and if we allow courts to do this, and we don't, our legal system would descend into anarchy, and ultimately it would collapse. Now, at this juncture in my remarks, some of you might say, or some of you might be thinking, well, who does Judge Jones think he is? Are judges beyond criticism for their decisions? Of course we aren't. And that isn't what I mean to say. Judges do not seek, and indeed no one should want, an unfettered judiciary free of accountability to anyone. We are accountable, but it is not to the politicians, it is not to the punditry, but we are accountable to the Constitution and to the laws of the United States of America. Judges are absolutely imperfect, sometimes deeply so, and I count myself in those ranks. But if we err, our decisions get appealed to a higher court for review. When we are wrong in the eyes of those reviewing tribunals, we are appropriately reversed. Earlier, I noted that the failure by some segments of the public to understand the need to have fair and impartial courts is becoming, I believe, in many cases, debilitating. Judges and their families are increasingly at risk due to what I believe are hostile segments of the public whipsawed by blatant and provocative misrepresentations by what I can only describe as a soundbite-driven punditry. Consider, for example, that last year my colleague in Chicago, District Judge Joan Lefkoe, suffered the unspeakable tragedy of the murder of her husband and mother by a person whose case she had dismissed. This person was lying in wait for her in her home, but he tragically encountered her husband and mother first, shot and killed them. We cannot know for sure if the killer of Judge Lefkoe's husband and mother, who later took his own life, was influenced by the creeping disrespect for the judiciary that I think is being fomented today through this misunderstanding of what we do. However, I'd respectfully suggest that it is entirely possible that he was. Last year in Florida, my colleague, another colleague of mine, Federal District Judge James Whittemore, experienced death threats after deciding the Terry Schiavo case. And he had those threats to a degree that necessitated that he have round-the-clock federal marshal protection for a protracted period of time. Judge Whittemore also suffered, as I have, what I would describe as career threats, as members of the United States Congress stood up in the wake of his decision and proclaimed that the people who were responsible for it would themselves be judged and held accountable. Now, I'm not certain what that means, but it clearly bespeaks a belief by certain politicians that judges are accountable to something other than the Constitution and the law. And for my part, too, I had U.S. Marshal protection during the week after I released my decision in the Dover case based on threats that were received in my chambers immediately after deciding the case. And if you would have told me when I got on the bench 4 years ago that I'd have death threats in a case like this, as opposed to, for example, a crack cocaine case where I mete out a heavy sentence, I would have told you that you were crazy, but I did, and it's a sad statement. Recently, Ann Coulter, who I will note is neither a personal fan of mine, nor did she like my decision, She, among other things, described me as a hack judge. She wrote a column in which she wished that Justice John Paul Stevens of the United States Supreme Court would encounter rat poison in his creme brulee. Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg revealed earlier this year that she and former Justice Sandra Day O'Connor had been the targets of death threats spurred by conservative critics of the Supreme Court, who called on the internet for the immediate patriotic killing of the justices. And these are but a few examples, as most of the threats that we receive as judges are never made public for obvious reasons. The bottom line is that if this doesn't stop, I am utterly convinced that we are very close to getting a judge killed or seriously hurt at the federal level. Certainly that has already happened to my colleagues in the state bench. It is appropriate for our purposes tonight at this most distinguished location and university to state that there is also an educational component to this problem. It involves, unfortunately, a failure to educate. Several months ago, former Justice O'Connor commented that, and I'm quoting now, public schools have pretty much stopped teaching government, civics, and American history. I truly don't know how long we can survive as a strong nation if our younger citizens don't understand our government. That is something that you have to learn. It just isn't handed down in the gene pool. Now, I don't mean this as a knock on our very capable teachers, but as we spend time, as we did in the Dover case, debating what to put in the science curriculum in our schools, we had better start paying attention to the curriculum in civics and government as well, and history. Increasingly, our students are graduating from high school without a good baseline of information about how our government works. And do you see how this leaves them exposed to all the misapprehensions that so many share about our system of justice? The bottom line, I think, is this. We have to stop encouraging and fomenting what I believe is a creeping civic stupidity about our courts. All of us, students, educators, concerned members of the public, the media, elected officials at all levels, and yes, judges themselves, have a role to play in the process of making things better. And there is, I think, a concomitant obligation to elevate the debate and ratchet down the inflammatory rhetoric that has become, as noted, all too prevalent. So let me bring my remarks to a conclusion by returning to several areas. First, we must never forget that the rule of law is not a conservative or liberal value. It is assuredly not a Republican or Democratic value. Rather, it is an American value. Confidence in the rule of law rests entirely at any given point in time on the character and the integrity of the individual American judge and the judge's absolute commitment to fairness and impartiality. To restate the obvious, judges are mortal, and as I have noted, we are deeply imperfect. However, we do no favor to the administration of justice when we either impose or imply public or political agendas on our courts. Our founding fathers envisioned an enlightened, educated public that could engage in spirited and even contentious debates about issues facing the nation. But I submit to you that they would be deeply chagrined to see an American public that collectively is so ill-informed and knows so little, not only about our court system, but also this magnificent system of government that they fought and in some cases died to create. In closing, then, I implore you to help me in my singular quest to take the debate about these issues to a higher and more educated plane, and I say that to you whether you agree with my decision in the Dover case or not. That's irrelevant. I know, as you do, that as long as there are courts deciding cases, there will be controversies about those decisions, and those who fundamentally disagree with the holdings that courts render, and that's as it should be. But let us debate those decisions from an enlightened perspective with a full understanding of how courts really work and without ad hominem attacks against the messengers. It has been my distinct honor and privilege to speak to you tonight. I'm going to take some questions at my peril, I suppose. We'll do that in a second, but I thank you for your attention. It's a real privilege to be here. Thank you.
While the questions are being collected along the aisles, Victor and I will take turns asking questions that we have come up with. Judge Jones, your thorough verdict in Kitzmiller versus Dover perhaps can be summarized in five words: don't mess with our Constitution. So there are two questions. Why do you think there is such confusion in the public mind about the separation of church and state? And second, does that confusion extend all the way to the Supreme Court?
I think there's some confusion, but I think there's also several schools of thought about the separation of church and state, and that's I could go on and on, and that's a very complex area, but. There has been on the Supreme Court, and I don't know about the current composition of the court because they haven't had a case since we got two new justices on a real meaty Establishment Clause case. But there's been a split on the Supreme Court, with the minority view being that the tests that we apply are inappropriate, and that we are reading too much into the First Amendment and into the Establishment Clause, and it was never meant to be utilized as strictly as the court has utilized it, say, over the last 60 or so years, you know, really dating back to the 1940s. So, you know, if there's a debate on the court, then there's going to be a debate publicly about those things as well. But as I said, the important lesson in the vein that I discussed tonight is that there are tests that are long established and that judges apply, and unless and until the Supreme Court of the United States determines that it wants to change those tests or alter the way that we handle Establishment Clause cases of this type, then we're going to continue to apply those tests. We have to in the lower courts. The great challenge for judges when you do these cases, and the challenge that the Supreme Court has in these areas, is to find a test that can be utilized in different areas, and that is extremely difficult because you can have anything, you can have a myriad of different fact situations that are subject to Establishment Clause challenges. And so it has been a changing process over time to try to get the tests focused and useful. But I think reasonable people differ about these things, and of course there are some, and this may or may not be a minority, I'm not sure. I don't know if they poll on this precise question, but there are some people who believe that what Thomas Jefferson said, you know, the wall of separation between church and state. Some of you students of history may know that came up in a letter that Thomas Jefferson wrote to the Danbury Baptists when he was elected president. And interestingly enough, the Danbury Baptists were happy about the election because they lived in a state that had been an establishment state. And people think that was an idle reference by Jefferson and didn't really bespeak the true intent of the people who framed out the First Amendment. I might or might not disagree with that, but you know, there are people who believe that strictly speaking, the First Amendment, that we have it right now, and there are people who believe that we're over applying it, and that's, I think, why there's a great controversy about it.
Unrelated question. Are we destined to keep fighting the same battle over the separation of church and state every 10 or 15 years via the law courts?
Now that probably gets into the personal belief that's irrelevant. History tells us that the battle has been fought now in courts since the Scopes monkey trial. If the past is a predictor, I suppose that there'll be something else in the future. I don't have the proverbial dog in that hunt, so I'll watch it with as much interest as any other citizen. Unless lightning strikes twice, I won't get another one of these cases on my docket, so I won't have to decide it. So.
Jess Jones, many scientists, me among them, shy away from debating creationists or ideas because debates are not about truth, but about winning. Both religion and science are demeaned by the tactics used in trying to win, and so debates become cheap entertainment. The question is this also true, or can this also be true of a court of law, that truth and law are demeaned? How do we keep trials from becoming cheap entertainment?
Well, the Dover case was decidedly not that, and we were discussing this at dinner with the folks who are on stage here. I got a motion 2 weeks before the trial from Court TV, and they wanted to televise the trial from wire to wire nationally. And there's a very strong bias in the federal courts about televising cases. And, if I made one mistake, it was that I denied that motion and I wouldn't let the case be televised. I've joked occasionally that all trial judges have that great negative role model who was poor Judge Ito in the O.J. Simpson case, and we, in our mind's eye, think about being pilloried on Jay Leno if we allow a case to be televised. But the lawyering was so good and so respectful, and it was noted by Victor that in the New Yorker article about the trial, they said it was like the biology course that you wished that you'd had, and I think that everybody who participated, and I hope I did, but I'm leaving myself out for the purpose of this answer, those who presented the case before me distinguished themselves in the case, and somebody won and somebody lost, but it was not because they didn't do it on an elevated plane and in a very eloquent appropriate fashion. So I think the Dover case stands as proof that you can do it in a very dignified way. I was proud of the lawyers. I was proud of the witnesses on both sides. I was proud of the presentations. I really thought that the participants were imbued with some sense that they might be engaged in something that was historic and that they conducted themselves in a way that consistent with that.
Okay. Well, I think we're going now to questions. When can precedent be overruled?
I should bring somebody up from the law school. Short version is this, so as not to bore you to death. I don't make precedent outside of Pennsylvania. My cases have effect in Pennsylvania in my court. But the next court up is the Court of Appeals, and then after that is the Supreme Court of the United States. The Third Circuit covers my area, and there are circuit courts across the United States. They can establish precedent, and if they do, all of the district courts within that circuit, multi-state circuit, have to follow it. The Supreme Court can overturn the precedent by the Court of Appeals. In other words, the Court of Appeals can overturn something that I do that takes care of that. That's the end of that, and it's no longer precedent within Pennsylvania. They can make their own law and precedent, but then the Supreme Court can have its way with that, and they can overrule that precedent. No one overrules, obviously, the Supreme Court. It is the highest court in the land, but the Supreme Court can overrule itself. It can reconsider cases somewhere downstream and say, look, we got it wrong the first time around, and we're going to change it, and we're going to do something differently. So only they can change something that they've established earlier, and they do in recorded history. It doesn't happen that frequently, but it does happen. It has happened a great number of times through the history of the court.
Judge Jones, a question from our audience. Given that officials at all levels of society, sports, business, education, legislature, Congress, the executive branch, display attentiveness to public opinion and funding in their decisions, how can you claim to personally stand above the ways, for good or evil, of our culture?
I'm not sure if I understand the question, but I'll try. The simple point that I was attempting to make, and I'm not sure if this answers the question, was that at any given time in the United States, there is a popular will. We're a very poll-driven society. The implication of the question seems to be that a judge, and I think courts are misperceived this way, that an arrogant judge can sort of stand in the way of what people want. Well, at any given time in the United States, what people want may not be in accordance, I'll say this as clearly as I can, like it or not. I mean, at any given time, it may not be consistent with what the Constitution and the laws of the United States say, and we're bound by that. We're accountable to the Constitution and the law, that's we make our decisions as according to that accountability, and not as according to the latest NBC Gallup poll, for example, that might say, again, in the context of the Dover case, that a great number of Americans, for example, believe that creationism ought to be taught as an alternative to evolution in public schools. If that's not consistent with the law, then we so find. And that is the role of the judiciary, like it or not. We're not running a popularity contest. I don't stand before you tonight as an elected official. I stand before you as a United States District Judge, and we are extremely cognizant of the fact that our decisions are occasionally very unpopular. As I said, understanding that, among my points tonight are that we can disagree without being disagreeable. We can try to avoid the ad hominem attacks, and we can elevate the debate to a certain degree. And, of course, the remedy, if you disagree with the decision that I render, is to take an appeal. I can get it wrong. I have gotten it wrong. And you do have the right to take it to a higher court, if that's the case.
The trial involved some theatrics in the form of a stack of science books in front of Michael Behe. Can a court devote enough time to really resolve technical details?
Courts do that every day. There is a case that's known as the Daubert case, and I don't want to get into excessive inside baseball, but it basically holds that a federal judge has to be a gatekeeper in terms of the scientific evidence and the worthiness of the scientific evidence that it receives. A lot of times in cases we get competing scientific theories, and we have to make a determination, for instance, in a jury trial, as to whether or not a particular theory or a particular mode of evaluating something is well-tested enough, peer-reviewed enough, it represents good science in a way that we can let the expert testify and say what he or she wants to say to the jury about a particular issue. So we do that every day. This was a Daubert-type analysis written larger. And again, I'm not sure exactly what the implication of the question is, and I don't want to try to read too much into it, but one thing that anyone who attended the Dover trial will tell you is that not one witness, not one, was cut off by me, or lawyer, I should say, was cut off by me in the examination of a witness. That's why the trial took 6 weeks. And everybody had their day, everybody had their say, everybody had the opportunity to fully examine and cross-examine witnesses. The particular vignette that you're talking about that involved Professor Behe, who I know is going to be here, was during his cross-examination, and that went on for a very long period of time, as did his direct examination. And I'm not going to get into inside baseball and what the stacking up of the books meant. You can read the trial transcript, but if the implication is that not enough time was devoted to to the examination or to the presentation of witnesses, I will show you a corner of my chambers with stacks and stacks of transcripts and submissions, and I would pretty easily disprove that. Everybody had their day.
Judge Jones, confirmation hearings give a distinct partisan impression. How can this be changed?
That there is always going to be a partisan aspect to confirmation hearings. I don't have an easy answer for that. I think it's a sign of the times. I do think that we have to avoid, as I said, the ad hominem attacks against the nominees. And it becomes cartoonish, I think, some of the confirmation hearings. And it's happened to both parties. And I bet you if you got some of the United States senators in a moment of candor and you got them alone, they'd say that they probably dislike it and they hate it. And they're almost playing roles that they think they've been scripted to play in the process because their constituencies, they believe, demand it. I think the public's probably sick of it. I'm not an advocate necessarily of the Senate rubber stamping a presidential nominee simply because it's the president's person. But I think, on the other hand, we're going to get to the point where we discourage good and qualified people from seeking judicial office. My confirmation went rather smoothly, but I know some people who've had a very rough go of it, and not for any flaw in their character or their ability to reason or their intelligence, but simply because they were the wrong place at the wrong time. And it's become a blood sport. I think the answer fundamentally is to elevate the debate. And it's okay to talk, particularly about a Supreme Court nominee, about ideology. I think that's fair game. It is the highest court in the land. I think it's less important as you go down to the lower courts. But we just need to elevate the debate, I think. That may be wishful thinking, but I hope for that.
Lost track of whose turn it was. Has the scope of the Kitzmiller decision been limited by the removal of the offending board prior to its release?
No, the decision, the fact that the board was removed, I think 8 out of 9 of the school board members lost the election about a month or so, before, a month and a half before I rendered the decision. But the successor board members, who were only sworn in very shortly before I rendered the decision, did not repeal the policy. They wanted a judicial determination, and so I decided the case. The election could only have had something to do with the decision if they had repealed the policy. Then there would have been an argument that the case was moot. There were some arguments that it wouldn't have mooted the case because the trial was held and the costs were incurred, but we never had to get to that point. So the election didn't really have any bearing on the decision itself because the policy was actually still in place at the time the decision was rendered.
Judge Jones, you mentioned that the American public school system has been unsuccessful in educating our population about government, civics, and so forth. As a recent high school graduate, I can confirm this. Honest individual. How can this be fixed, particularly with respect to those already through the system?
I recognize, now I say this probably with some newspaper reporters here tonight, for many people, it's this simple. Newspapers are an anachronism for some people, and I don't think that they should be. You can read them online, or you can read them like I choose to do as a more traditional person in hand. I read a number of newspapers. In fact, I read as many newspapers as I get my hands on every day. I like that. Different viewpoints, interesting to me, always have, going back to the time that I was a young person. It expands not just, I think, your vocabulary and your general intelligence, but it also gives you a broader sort of worldview of things, of current events. So I don't, I think it's inappropriate to lay this at the feet of teachers and vilify teachers and say, or school boards or, those who plan the curriculum. I think that's only one component. I do think we need to have a stronger component of American history and civics, and it starts there. I think that's one place. But very frankly, if we have incurious students, you know, who don't care to understand current events and who don't engage and understand these things, and you know, who are staring at a computer screen but not to get any current events or news, then this thing is going to continue to perpetuate. So I think the challenge for anybody who's out of high school, who's moving along in their lives, and I hope you are all curious, but you know, is to stay engaged. You know, you can't watch 5 minutes of news, or if you watch that even, every night and have any hope to understand what is taking place in the world. You know, read, engage, you know, you can find that you can broaden your horizons on your own without the aid of education. But I mean, there are some structural things we can do in the schools. Justice O'Connor, former Justice O'Connor, who's now honorary chancellor at the William & Mary Law School, has made this a cornerstone of her post Supreme Court life, and she is really, as I noted from the quote, I mean, she is really on a quest to see that we consider curriculum changes and enhancing existing courses. And I think it's great because, you know, if you don't understand your fundamental rights, and there have been some polls and you know, the poll numbers, if you read them out loud, they can glaze you over. But there are polls, though, that I've read that show shocking misapprehensions about the First Amendment by students in high schools. Maybe you've seen them, too. Majority of students polled, for example, thought that newspapers had to have the government review what they were going to publish in advance before it got into the newspaper. You know, startling deficiencies and a misunderstanding about the way the Constitution operates and the way government works. And you know, in the vernacular, if you don't understand your rights, you're going to get rolled in the legal process. You're going to be susceptible to having those rights taken away. And every day I see litigants in court, you know, and sometimes they represent themselves. They shouldn't, but they in complex cases, but they do, and they're at a dreadful disadvantage because they don't have even the slightest grasp of what their fundamental rights are, and that's where it becomes extremely problematic, I think.
Well, this is the penultimate question. Casey Luskin, a recent law school graduate at the Discovery Institute, has written extensively on your decision. Do his opinions have any basis in law?
No. I'm just kidding. I don't know. I haven't, that's a very glib answer, and I apologize for that. But the Discovery Institute does not like my decision. They are proponents of intelligent design, and they're on a quest, I think, to analyze and superanalyze the decision. I can't claim to have read. I may have seen some of the things that Mr. Luskin has written, and not others. And he's free. He's got his First Amendment rights. He can say what he wants. And my decision has been rendered, and more power to him if he wants to do that. I simply don't know.
And this is the final question. Judge Jones, if a lawyer does a poor job of presenting the scientific evidence for his side, but the judge is aware of those scientific facts from his own or her own knowledge base, is the judge limited to just the facts presented when making a judgment?
That's a pretty good question. You know, you have to take it in the context of the Dover case, I guess. You know, there are certain principles of physics, for example, and things that you may know and you may recall that are sort of immutable that I suppose you could apply in cases. But in the context of the Dover case, I can't think of anything that applied to the scientific testimony that had to do with my own personal beliefs. I got every bit, believe me, after 6 weeks, I got every bit of the information that I needed to decide the case, both plaintiff's side and defendant's side, during that case. So I can't think of, some external source that I would have used, and I think inappropriately had I used it, in order to decide the decision. In other words, can I overlay a defective fact presentation with something that I know from outside? Not in that type of case. No, I couldn't. Now, in another case, in another time, if somebody would present something that would simply fly in the face, if I have an expert, I mean, to be absurd, if I had an expert who espoused a theory that disregarded the existence of gravity, you could easily see that you could utilize some personal knowledge that you have, but that was not the case. This was a pretty technical presentation on both sides, mind-numbingly so, I might say, at certain times, and so it had to be endured and utilized in finding facts. Obviously, the challenge to a judge is you have to accept some of the testimony and you reject other testimony, but it was well presented, and it was presented in a very fulsome fashion. Thank you all. Appreciate the opportunity.
Judge Jones will be in the room opposite this conference hall if you're wanting to talk with him any further.